Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week we're on the Oregon coast out of Garibaldi for lingcod and rockfish. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf and this is Angler West Television.
Heading out to do a little bit of bottom fishing, crabbing today out of Garibaldi. Garibaldi is one of our, what I consider our north coast fisheries here in Oregon. Really great opportunity for lingcod, wide variety of bottom fish, and do a little bit of crabbing today. But Garibaldi's about north of Tillamook, 10 miles, guys, or so? Not too far. Just one of those small communities that you happen to zip by when you're cruising on 101. But it's a really neat place. You ever get an opportunity, you know, stop by and take advantage of some of the fishing and crabbing that takes place out of this port here. So we're gonna come out of the marina. You gotta be careful in this marina, especially in the low tide that we're at now. Got a lot of sandbars. If you look out here, you see all sorts of sandbars sticking out. So make sure to stick to your channel markers there. When we come out of the jetty, we're gonna come off the north side there and go drop some crab pots. We're gonna let those soak for the day. And then we're gonna run due south-southwest there for about 20, 30 minutes to get to a couple areas where we have a tendency to find quite a bit of lingcod. So we're gonna target our lingcod. If we could get our 2 lingcod per person, then we're gonna switch over and catch bottom fish. We will catch our bottom fish while we're lingcod fishing, but really gonna work on getting those couple lingcod per person. Those are the creme de la creme, if you will, of the sea. And so great table fare. So I like focusing on those before we go catch our bottom fish there. So what we have now is what's called a negative tide. Obviously all of our tides are based on a lunar pool, right? So the bigger the moon, the more of a tide exchange that we're gonna have. One of the things to keep in mind when you're crossing the bars out here in Oregon or Washington or any coast for that matter, the larger moon you have, the more tide exchange, the more water distribution you're gonna have coming from the ocean into the river and vice versa. So that can make for a little bit of a challenging bar crossing. One of the things that we always are mindful of is that bar crossing, and we wanna make sure we're crossing at an appropriate safe time. And that is on that incoming tide is when you're gonna have your safest crossings there. So that's what we're always looking for there, is that incoming tide to be able to cross the bar. But with those tides, we also get some really good fishing opportunities. So it's something to be mindful of, but something to look forward to when it comes to fishing. Let's go ahead and drop them. What we're looking for in here is just a smooth, consistent bottom. We found them in here pretty consistently. Go ahead, Jeff, go ahead and toss that one, bud. And we're in 30 feet of water. I don't run a crab davit on my boat. If you can't pull a crab pot out of 30 feet of water, then, well, I'm gonna question your manhood. Jack, go ahead and drop another one, buddy.
You ready?
Send it. Oh, wait, hold on.
Well, my pot's way the other end.
Oh, yeah, go ahead and send it, bud.
I'll get a little more distance.
That's good. Jack. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna run a straight course. It's really nice when you have a buddy with you or a couple buddies with you that know what's going on. If you don't, take the time to train them up and it works a lot better, makes your day a lot more comfortable on the water. But what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna run a straight line and just start dropping them. That way when I come pick them up, I know exactly the line I wanna run and be able to find them all again. What we're doing on these ropes is when I put my crab pots away from the trip before, I open up the crab trap, I pull all the rope and I stuff it inside, okay? I rarely coil it. Go ahead, Jack, if you're ready. There's an old saying, a piled rope never tangles. So I pile it up inside the crab trap. And then when we come out and fish the next day, what I do is I let the buoys and the line out and I'll just drag them around until we're ready to drop that pot. We'll bait them and pitch them in there. What we're using today is the Fishfield crab traps here.
Jack, I'm gonna send this one.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm holding mine.
Yeah, go ahead, Brian. And we'll just keep on running them out until we're out of crab traps and we're gonna go kill some bottom fish. We're using some shad for bait today and I had them marinating in Procure crab sauce there, so overnight. So it should be nice and
ready when you're ready, bro.
Go ahead and send it. I see a big old jumbo on the screen. He's like an 8-incher, buddy. All right, we're crabbing just like that. There's a couple different pinnacles out here, a couple different pieces of structure that I like focusing on. A lot of what I do starts with before I leave that kitchen table. And what I mean by that is we have some charts that I purchased, and we'll sit around and eat dinner and crack a couple beers and put a game plan together, and you'll be surprised at what you can find on those charts before you ever come out here. And it's a great way to find new locations, mark it on your chart, locate it on your GPS, put a waypoint on there, and come out and fish that spot. That's really the only way to find these spots, opposed to somebody giving you numbers and giving you that location, which is all good and well, but it's kind of nice to be able to find your own fishing ground. So we're gonna run down a few miles here and hopefully drop it on some lean cod and put some fish in the box there.
Welcome back to the Oregon Coast. I'm Justin Wolf. We're fishing out of Garibaldi Marina with Pro Escobedo of VIP Outdoors. Now, after dropping our crab pots, we're making a short run south, looking for lingcod and rockfish.
Oh, this is nice out here.
Oh, man.
There's a good chance I'm gonna be falling asleep today. That's why I wear the dark sunglasses.
Is Hyman gonna water ski?
That's what he said.
Okay, I'll try that.
Oh, this looks like an outside of Neatarts.
Yeah.
Is that right?
It is. That is, yeah.
That's Neatarts. That's Kickle Top. Holy cow.
We're going for the big one,
buddy.
Look
at that.
That sucks. Is. We're going to put it to the test right away. All righty. Finally got out to our first mark here. What I generally do when I sit down into a certain area is I put the boat in neutral and I see which way it's naturally drifting. And then what I do is I position the boat to be able to cover a large drift and actually make a fish going through there, okay? So right now we're set up just the way we want to be. We're actually drifting to the southeast a little bit, which is not too bad. It's a really slow drift, so you don't have to use as much lead. Basic setup here. I'm gonna use one of our dropper leaders here. Okay, this is actually a Mighty Mini swivel up here. And then these double loop droppers with pre-tied flies on there. Bunch of different manufacturers you could get them from. You could get them from P-Line. Fishfield has their own line. And then we come down to another Mighty Mini snap swivel there, stainless steel. And this right here is actually a 20 ounce. You could use 16 or 20. I bet you today we could get away with 16. The more people you have on your boat, the heavier weight you're gonna want. That way everything drops perfectly vertical and you don't have so many tangles, especially when that drift picks up. So we're gonna go ahead and put this guy on there. I'm gonna put some of our Procure scent on there. We got one of those guys. This right here is a new Procure scent that we're lucky enough to have them make for us. So I can't give you the secret recipe yet, but we're gonna get that thread in there. All right. This is their gel formula, which sticks to plastic very, very, very well. Okay. All right. So, is the boat ready to fish yet? Everybody got something on there, Jack? What do you got, buddy?
Right, your curly tail.
Okay. You got a fishing rod, or you're just going to put it down there, buddy, with your hand?
I'm just going to drop it in there.
You're just going to put your hand in the water?
You said there were that many fish.
You didn't get the top waters going, huh?
Plastic works well over here, and I'm going to try some lead fish jigs. Of course, I got some secret weapon. Procure bait wax herring. Okay, this thing is super awesome. I can put it in my pocket and just barely twist it, put on the surface. One layer, the other end, and doesn't block the color. That's a nice thing. See, under the sun, it's still shining. Alrighty, I'm in the game.
Right in that pocket, buddy.
Dude, we're moving faster than I thought. You got one? Oh, Jeff's already hooked up back here.
Here we go.
Yeah, dude, we're smoking.
Woohoo!
Let me get.
Think we got a good one here.
Let me back in there a little bit, Jeff.
Watch those.
Oh, little guy. Working it.
Little cutie.
It's a little bit of a tussle. I'm not sure who has who yet.
It's the mother of all lings. Brian, will you do me a favor? Grab that other gaff.
I got you.
We're going to hang them right up here, buddy, for today. Look at this right here. So we got an easy access.
I'm at 15. We're going to be coming up. We'll see what we got here.
Oh, I got a fish on this one.
Oh, I got a big ling.
Yep, yeah, there we go.
Big right. Ling, guys.
Right behind you. And we got a small ling.
So, double.
We got this guy here, which is a really nice quality ling. He bit that P-line ling cod jig. And then we had this guy right here, who just silly enough to follow him, but he got hooked by the bat jig. So that's a foul hook there. And we're gonna go ahead and let him go. But it's a great way to start our day with that guy right there.
That's a great one. Here, I need a gap.
Yo, you need a gap.
Yeah!
I almost shit the bed on that one, didn't I? Hey.
Nice job!
All right work, Wayne.
Oh, look at that thing.
What'd you do?
That's the mother of all
lings. That's the mother of all ling cod there, amigo.
A lot of tacos.
A lot of fish tacos right there. By the way, I'm gonna put this on TV right now. You use corn tortillas for fish tacos. This flour tortilla stuff, I'm putting a squash on it.
Flour's not an option.
Flour's not an option, buddy. Good work, Jack.
Thanks, bud.
We're starting to load the box on the Oregon coast with ling cod and rockfish, despite the heavy current.
Yeah, we're moving pretty good. That's what I was telling you out here. It's tough to...
Want me to stick a knife in him,
bud? Even with the 16 to 20 ounces, it's pretty tough.
Want me to knife him?
Yeah, let's bleed him in the box, though.
Look at the teeth on that guy.
Hey!
Look at this guy! Whoa, boy!
He's an angry bird.
Stick your hand in the top.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'll do it.
Look at that thing.
Wow. We're getting to the far side of the drift, guys. So, what's happening is we're starting at one side and we're cruising across the drift here. Now, it seems like every time we fish, you gather a few new waypoints and we mark them every time. Every time we get into a heavy concentration of fish, I mark a waypoint on there. And what that does is that just helps me for the next time I'm out here to make a longer drift or pinpoint them when they're being finicky.
Hey, that one's right in there. How about that? Right in there. Oh, boy.
Come on, boys. See, so I was actually getting ready to pick up and move because we're off of our waypoints, but we went through there and a couple rods got bit, so I'm going to keep on fishing it until those fish tell me not to fish anymore. Drop it down with the deep.
I'm trying, bud. I'm going to fish.
If you got, just drop it down, Jeff. Do it yourself.
Well, the fish is swimming my jig back.
Oh, here we go. I'm getting bit right here.
Come on, baby.
Gonna go here.
So I might have to put the boat sideways to everybody fish off one side.
Yeah.
On this next drift, we'll do that. Right now, you have to get those things up over the motor.
Well, I can't really get them over there.
That one, Ivan?
Oh, that's
I got a yellow eye. A yellow eye? All righty. A lot of guys will have a designated rod for the descender. I usually just use the same rod and put it right back down on there. So you take this guy. Clip it on there just like that onto the lower jaw. Depending on your overall depth, it has different settings on there. Okay, so this one's 50 feet deep. I'm gonna send it a little bit deeper. Okay, probably down around 100 feet is where I'm gonna send this guy. And we'll be good to go. Go ahead, drop her down in there, Jeff.
We'll drop it
back
down.
This is a perfect one for that frying deal that we're doing, Jack.
Let it
Did
go.
Did you fast. Try those?
Oh, they're phenomenal. So this is a canary fish, very distinct three marks across the gill plate there, 1, 2, 3. That's the way I identify them. Easiest for me to identify them just like that. Really good eating fish. Very distinct lateral line on there. Really good quality eating fish here.
Well, we're going to try some Fishfield Thumbertail. This is 9-inch glow ghost. We had a lot of luck during the past fishing trips, and today we'll try this again and try and catch some big lingcod.
Got a couple different species on here. We got...
Double rockfish.
Got a Chinese rockfish here. Okay. There's not a lot of meat on these. I usually let these guys go. They are legal to kill, but not a lot of meat on them, so I'd let those swim.
Bro, we doubled up. You want
to? Did you? This is a yellow. Let's kill that bottom one, maybe. Okay. So these right here, we got into these again. These are the yellow fins. Okay, another species of rockfish. These are really good eating. This one looks to be pretty healthy. His bladder's still in there, a little on the small sides. I'm going to let him go. That's one of the things about bottom fishing that I think maybe we could be better about is self-regulating.
This one's,
you know,
cooler,
just,
huh?
Yeah, let's kill that guy. You know, a lot of fisheries where we have the opportunity to harvest a lot of fish, we're really good at over-harvesting. But with these guys, a little bit of self-regulation goes a long ways in leaving good quality fish for generations to come, and even for the next trip, you know.
Just hook one fish on Fishfield blue water jigs. Today the current is really strong, so I got to use the 224 gram. But once I touch the bottom, a few bouncing and got a fish on. Feels like a rockfish.
Fish on there.
Yeah, okay. Smalling, huh?
I think it might be a few, nah, he's a little small.
Yeah, what that thing speed out.
Does he see cucumber?
Yeah, it kind of looks like.
Is that right?
Maybe. No, he's small, we can do better than that.
Welcome back to the Oregon Coast. I'm Justin Wolf. We're fishing the dark depths with thumpertail swim baits and a variety of jigs and rockfish rigs, looking for limits of great eating lingcod and a wide variety of Pacific rockfish.
Big cloud of fish right here, guys. Our screen's loaded. They're all the way from 150 down to 200.
Part of the beauty about bottom fishing is, I should say it's a kind of double-edged sword, because by nature we want to go back to where we know we're catching them. It's almost a guarantee that we're going to get them when we go through that drift, but you're never going to find any new water if you don't try new things, right? And being able to find those new spots for the next time you come out is very, very important. So when you get towards the end of your limit, I challenge you to go find some new water, and you'll never know what you're going to find. We came out a little deeper here. Karen hooked up.
Nicely done. There's two.
Oh yeah, that thing is fighting. Okay, we're fishing 200 feet of water, and the fish are right on the bottom. So I was using a Fishfield blue water jig, which is super glow and darn dark there. It works pretty well.
Oh, yeah, that's a keeper. Yeah, kill that thing. That's a China rockfish.
China. Is that a China?
Or a quillback, let me see.
Quillback.
Is it a quillback?
It's a quillback. On the system.
Yeah, that's a quillback. Went through some quillbacks
there. This
is
a big quillback. On the sisterhood.
There's like no meat on those things, man.
Okay. Well, that's a solid hook. I might have to get a plier hook, take the hook out.
So we just counted our rockfish. Where we're fishing here is 5 rockfish per person plus your 2 lingcod. We're a little short on our lingcod. Once we get to about 33, what we'll do is we'll pull our fish out, wash them off, and get an accurate count just to make sure we're within legal limits. And we'll go check our crab pots and probably wrap her up and call her a day. So good day of bottom fishing and looking for a couple more lingcod. Started off strong with them, and I don't know where they went. All the big ones anyways. Keep catching some small ones, but we're gonna keep working at it.
Double.
A little one, definitely too small on the bottom. This one's borderline. We're gonna check this guy.
We're limited of the rockfish. I'm hoping we get a lingcod. Then we can wrap up to check our crab pots. Okay, well, it feels like a ling. Or maybe a rockfish, big one.
Well, that's a nice ling.
Yeah, nice ling there. That fish field jig. Was it 224 grams, Ivan?
Yes.
Nice jig.
Is Zeke gonna keep this bait right here?
Rub top. Thank you, Pro.
Nice job, buddy. Good work.
Good job, bud.
Today I got all the fish on the sister hook, on the top hook, plus the Procure beadwax herring scent.
Got a couple. Just pulled our first pot and we got a pile of crab in there. So far, no keepers. That looks like our first keeper. Hyben's gonna be doing our measuring for us there. How do those shells feel, guys? The shells feel pretty good. So this is one of Hyben's crab pots here over at, or a fish filled crab pot, and it's got double doors on there, which I like. There's a couple improvements we made to it. One of them is in the clip that keeps the top shut there. We bent that a little bit so it stays shut. Also on these doors, that hinge, let me pull one off real quick. I take these and I actually pinch them down a little bit tighter so that they don't ever come off. And we've had a lot of success with them. We're super happy with them. But yeah, we got four more pots to pick up after this guy here. And that was a good pick. That one was short? That one without the pinchers, let's throw him back.
Hey, I hope you enjoyed today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, there would be no show. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.